Yeah, look, listen, I'm not actually feeling too bad. Obviously, it's a very disappointing day. It's a day that I suppose 18 months ago I never thought it would come. It's a day where, you know, I reflect a lot. Reflect on the good times, reflect on the bad times. But look, listen, I stand here in front of all the media today and I turn around and say I have no regrets. I've enjoyed every single minute of it. I've loved being a part of Ulster and Irish Rugby. I've had the privilege of playing for the British and Irish Lions. I've achieved so much success in my career. But unfortunately, I've had to hang the boots up a couple of years earlier than I expected to. But look, listen, rugby's a contact sport. I know the first minute I picked up a rugby ball, that's the way it was. But that's why I loved it. And look, listen, it's been a privilege, but got to look forward to the next chapter of my life.
Lots of memories in there in those number of years you were with Ulster. I guess taking you back to the beginning, you started in around the same time as Rory Best. The two of you have become firm friends.
Yeah, no, Rory's 100%. He's a good mate. He's a guy who I have a lot of respect for. He puts in the hard work. Turns out week in, week out, and puts in unbelievable performances. Off the pitch, he's an absolute gentleman. He's a great leader. Off the pitch, all the young guys coming through, they all look up to him. But he's a mate. He's somebody that I've, I suppose, over the last, more so probably over the last 5 or 6 years, that I've grown real close to. And yeah, you know, look, listen, I can walk away from rugby, I've made a lot of good friends, but certainly Rory's definitely up there. It's my best mate.
When you started with Ulster at a time when they were sort of on the high, they won the Celtic League. You were a part of that team. You were in Swansea that night and you enjoyed the celebrations after. I photographs, if you remember that night, you were wearing shirts when you went out after.
I'm not sure if we're wearing the shirts.
You weren't wearing them. And Roger Wilson stole my camera and took a lot of photographs, which I came across the other day. I must let you see them. But you came into Ulster at a time where they were on a high. And then they just didn't kick on.
No, that was very frustrating. And I think, you know, more or less Humph wasn't really playing well, and that's why we didn't play that well. Like, you know, everybody was covering Humph. But now, look, listen, it was one of those times where we thought Ulster rugby was going to take off. Crowd attendances were starting to get up. And, you know, 2 years later, we're sacking coaches. Crowd attendances are down around 5,000. You know, we're like, oh, you know, we're not looking too good here. But, look, listen, the way it's been over the last 4 or 5 years, putting the right people in the right places, you know, putting Humph where he is. You know, you have the strength and conditioning staff, Johnny Davis, Kevin Geary, David Drake, you know, Amy Davis, all in there, making the place tick. We have a good medical team in place. When you start winning, you start getting fans. When you start winning more and more, you get more and more fans. And when you start winning week in, week out, you get sellouts. And success breeds success, and it's just been great to be a part of the journey where we came from the pits. Like, it was dark days, crisis meetings, you name it, you know, not knowing what's around the corner, you know, potentially leaving the club, you know, I need to go and play somewhere else. But all the boys here from here stuck around and made it happen. You know, Rory Best, because he easily went over to France and got himself a big deal, but he didn't, he stuck by it. Myself, Paddy Wallace, even younger guys that were coming through like Darren Cave, you know, brought in a couple of marquee players like Justin Harrison to try and get the place going again. And then, you know, I suppose the last couple of years, Brian McLaughlin came in, done such a good job. Got a couple of world-class players, John Afoa, Johan Muller, Ruan Pienaar, and then you keep the core group of Ulster players here, and things start to happen. And just to go back, you know, it's just that journey from 05-06 to where we are now, to being a mediocre team, you know, a team that nobody feared, to nobody wants to ever come to this ground and play Ulster rugby. You know, we're a European force to be reckoned with, and it's great to be part of that whole process.
On the Ireland front, you made your debut against the Pacific Islands. that was a night that was an emotional night for Lansdowne Road. It was the old Lansdowne Road, the closing of that was a real chapter, but it was the beginning of your chapter in an Irish jersey.
Yeah, look, you know, I tend to forget these things. You know, it was the last ever international Lansdowne Road.
Paddy Wallace got his first cap.
Yeah, and he was one of the highest point scorers of all time in an Irish jersey. I think he kicked 9 from 10 conversions that day, and I played really well. You know, got my first cap with Jamie Heaslip, Luke Fitzgerald. You know, Jamie's went on to, I think he's maybe close to 70 caps now. You know, so it just shows that I've missed out on a lot of rugby over the years. But yeah, it's been an Irish journey where it's been a memorable one, that's for sure. You know, World Cup 2007, not getting selected, but putting that behind me and using that to my advantage, gained a lot of experience out there and made sure I was ready and firing on all cylinders for the 2011 World Cup. You know, great Grand Slam year in 2009, followed by the Lions, and then just wanted to push on and to be involved in a World Cup and to play more or less every minute of that World Cup was fantastic. You know, even though we didn't perform that well against Wales, it was great place to be. We were playing some fantastic stuff. The crack off the field was mighty, and making lifelong friends is what's most important.
And after that World Cup, you came back to Ulster, and again injury hit you. You were sidelined. How did you deal with all of that?
Everybody says to me, you know, I walk around with a smile on my face most of the time, but that's just me, you know. It's been a bloody tough 18 months. Not just tough for me, but tough for the people close to me, like Laura, mum and dad, even the guys here in the team. You know, they were expecting me back within, you know, a couple of months, but a couple of months turned into 18 months. But I'm glad I was able to get myself fit and back for a couple of games. But unfortunately, the ankle just couldn't cope with it. Couldn't cope with the professional game. Couldn't cope with the training load. And I've had to, unfortunately, hang up the boots. But look, listen,
no regrets.
I look back on it with a smile on my face, as always.
Well, that night when you did make the comeback, you were in that dugout down there, and the noise in this stadium was unbelievable. You pulled off the jacket, you pulled on the cap, and on you came. What were you thinking?
Well, it was bloody sick of Kev Geary making me do up and downs and down that back behind the post down there. He was like, Stevie, right, 20 sprints. I'm like, hold on a second. I don't need to get a second wind here. Like, I want to go on and keep something in the tank here. I'm knackered. So I was actually puffing a bit coming up from Kev, making me more or less do a fitness session before going out to play my first match back in 18 months. But look, listen, come back. Ryan put up a lovely box. I was just so thankful I wasn't in the five-man lineout, because I didn't hardly knew a call, because I hadn't done many lineouts over the previous 3 or 4 weeks. The guy caught it, just hit him pretty well.
Did you check yourself ever so slightly?
Yeah, I did. Look, listen, I could have hit him a bit earlier. I could have hit him, you know, maybe a second earlier, but I think I might have been a little bit early. I was just timed it perfect. And I was like, right, geez, I'm back in this, you know, I'm back. There was a couple of sprints over on the far side. I got my hands on the ball. Like, I think I made 8 carries in 20 minutes, you know, and I don't think I made 8 carries in the other 3 games that I played. So it was just good to get back in. I was like, right, any doubt that I had about my ankle over the last 6 weeks before I prepared for coming back into playing was out the window. That was me. I was back. I was feeling good. But then, you know, It's all fun and games when you're playing rugby. It's post, you know, and my ankle was just swelling up, getting sore, and then the next game, getting even worse, and just snowballed. So, but it was good to go back and hit your man. Like,
well, I think the whole crowd, you lifted nearly the roof of the stadium, as it were. But it was a fitting farewell, so to speak. Let the younger people who maybe didn't see you play in your day just see what you're capable of doing. You were a monster out there. And, you know, on behalf of all the fans, thank you very much, Stevie. We've enjoyed watching you. We know that you're not going to leave rugby now. You're obviously going to try and keep involved in some way, are you?
Yeah, well, look, listen, Paul McGee of Dungannon's been in contact with me, and I'm going to help out there. I'm not going to be an official coach for Dungannon, but myself and Nigel Brady, who used to be at Ulster a couple of years ago, a lot of people remember Nigel. they're going to help out down there next season, try and get the club thriving again. But look, it's something that I think I just need to get a bit of a break. Of course, I would love to stay involved within rugby. I think it would be stupid of me not to stay involved in some capacity. I think I might take Humph's job. I need a couple of years of experience. And I need to go and do a degree in, what's he in, accounts? Law did he do? Actually, that's easy enough. Like, I'll do that in about 6 months. Took him 10 years, I think. The amount of exams he failed. So, Humph's job would obviously be good. You know, I think 450 grand a year he's on. I'll be all right. But, I need to get my teeth into something. But it's definitely not going to be for another couple of months. Just need to relax, take it easy. Keep involved in Ulster rugby from the stands next year, but obviously help out a little bit with Dungannon and RFC, and you never know what's around the corner.
Stevie, many thanks.
No bother, thank you, cheers.
So here goes then from Isaac Foss. 10 minutes of the second half played. Ulster trailing by 11. Back inside beautifully to Andrew Trimble. Almost tap tackle.
Fantastic, the inside pass beat that on Russian Cardiff play. Fantastic, about time Ulster, brilliant play from Trimble.
Wallace into contact, then Lancusha. O'Connor, deeper. Best had to improvise. Stephen Ferris standing up two Cardiff players and the fullback Stephen Ferris. It's no contest whatsoever. Ulster's blindside flanker just more.
How much purchase into the performance of Will Guinea half back, but he's just hassled and harried, taken back. Ferris, Paul O'Connell, Donegal, Callaghan. That's exactly what Ireland need to do. If Ireland have been saving some moves in their back line for the World Cup, but the important matches at that, this surely is the time. See what they can do.
Well taken. Pienaar gets it away. Lovely wristy pass. Cave. Here's Ferris. Needs to give it. Decides not to. Is he going to get a second Ferris? There's no stopping Stephen Ferris. Can you put a price on this fella? He is immense.
Well, he's a full package, isn't he?
Ireland have been threatening that for the last phase of plays, and it just look, there's a look on Mills Mulliani's face as he gets up from that tackle of disbelief. They've scored against us. Now we've got a bit of a game on.
It was all about surviving.